Okay, the final item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3226 in the name of Pam Gosal on Scottish Apprenticeship Week 2022. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I'd be grateful if anybody wants to participate in the debate could press the request to speak buttons or place an R in the chat function. And I call on Pam Gosal for around 7 minutes. Ms Gosal.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I am grateful for the opportunity to open my very first Members' Business Debate. I welcome colleagues from across the Chamber to speak on my motion acknowledging Scottish Apprenticeship Week 2022. As the Shadow Spokesman for Further Education and Training, I am pleased to be able to mark this week for the first time since being elected. This year's theme is Apprenticeships Work, and so I will dedicate my speech to the ability of apprenticeships to transform career prospects, address gaps in the labour market, and advance on our economy. I would like to offer thanks to Apprenticeship Scotland, Skills Development Scotland, and the Construction Industry Training Board for not only providing me with helpful briefings ahead of this debate, but also for their hard work all year round, facilitating links between learners and employers. I would certainly like to commend every employer who has taken a chance on a keen learner and considers apprenticeships a worthwhile investment. As we know, apprenticeships are work-based learning opportunities or jobs with industry-recognised qualifications. Over 12,000 employers support Scottish apprenticeships, and it is estimated that there are currently around 43,000 apprentices across Scotland. Right now, in 2022, a dramatic skills shift is taking place because factors such as COVID-19 and COP26 declarations. The long-lasting changes in the jobs market that COVID-19 has created means that skills shortages are becoming increasingly commonplace. Around two-thirds of Scottish companies are struggling to find employees that possess the required skills, and further 74% anticipate the need to upskill their staff. And the journey to net zero will require nothing short of green skills revolution. Projects such as the mass retrofitting of Scotland's households will require skill sets which, as it stands, are few and far between. And as these are exactly the type of dilemma that apprenticeships can accommodate, for the reason they will play a fundamental role in our economic recovery. Unexpectedly, many businesses are experiencing increased demand but do not have the capacity to expand their operations. While we are currently seeing many school leavers going into higher education, this should not be the determinant of the other learning pathways. And so, across the Chamber, I believe it is essential to stress the importance of apprenticeships and the opportunities that they afford to learners. University is not for everyone, and it is important to diversify the skills we equip workers with. If everybody had the same set of skills, there would be a lack of diversity in thought, innovation and creation.
Would Pam Gosal
agree on
that point?
Yes, I would.
Stephen Kerr.
Would Pam Gosal agree that apprenticeship is not a second best to a university place?
Pam Gosal.
I thank the member for that intervention. Absolutely, it should never be second best. It should be there for as a choice for every learner. During my teenage years, my father took me under his wing and showed me the ropes of his business. While today we may call this process an apprenticeship, the truth is that this practice has been around for many long years. It wasn't until he sadly passed away that I decided I had to step up and take over the business and provide for my family. Despite leaving school with no qualifications or experience, what I learnt from my father was invaluable. I later decided to return to formal education as a mature student alongside my work, and due to my untraditional route into education, I'm a huge advocate for gaining on-the-job experience with apprenticeships, which apprenticeships provide. But there is still more we need to do to ensure everyone is afforded the same access to apprenticeships. Employers such as Glenmorangie, who my colleague Sue Webber visited yesterday, say they are still struggling to attract female apprentices into what is perceived as a male-dominated industry. A concern I heard myself when I visited the new college, Lanarkshire in Kirkintilloch. They also warn that apprenticeships are easier to access in some local authorities than others, and that more needs to be done to this postcode lottery. Just this morning, in the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, I was able to raise the importance of ensuring that apprentices are accessible to all groups, including disabled people. And when meeting with apprentices in Alloa yesterday, my colleague Alexander Stewart learned that there needs to be better engagement with third sector organisations to maximise apprenticeship opportunities in these settings. But we'd also like to listen to apprentices themselves. Apprentices like Kieran, who I met in Dumbarton yesterday, in his apprenticeship with Dingbro, Kieran is learning skills that will set him up for his whole career. But he feels that for some young people, current apprenticeship pay is not enough to incentivise them to follow this career path. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, it is clear that apprenticeship work, they work for apprentices, employers, the local economy and the wider community. And for that reason, I would conclude with three things we can all do to help apprenticeships fulfil their potential role. Firstly, by engaging with individuals, businesses, educators and apprenticeships providers to better align skills provision with demand and future trends. Secondly, as members across this Parliament visit apprentices and employers to mark Scottish Apprenticeship Week, it is important we ask what more can we do to improve access into this career pathway. And lastly, by encouraging young people to properly consider every career pathway that is open to them. No single pathway is right for everyone, and we should encourage people to take a truly open-minded approach to this issue.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Gosal. I now call on Kenneth Gibson to be followed by Rona Mackay for around 4 minutes, please, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I would like to congratulate Pam Gosal on securing this debate during Scottish Apprentice Week and for sharing with us her own experiences. Scotland has 43,000 apprentices who are acquiring first-hand industry experience suitable for responding to the nation's ever-changing employment skill needs. These opportunities play an essential role in the nation's economic renewal as we recover from the pandemic.
Mr Gibson, could you maybe just adjust your microphone? Thank you.
Apologies. Do you want me to start again? No.
I'll leave that to your discretion, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to congratulate Pam Gosal on securing this debate during Scottish Apprentice Week and for sharing her own personal experiences. Scotland has 43,000 apprentices who are acquiring first-hand industry experience suitable for responding to the nation's ever-changing employment skill needs. These opportunities play an essential role in the nation's economic renewal as we recover from the pandemic. Work-based learning systems help to address skills shortages and boost productivity. And with over 12,000 employers offering apprenticeships, the opportunity to learn on the job significantly reduces youth unemployment, with 92% of modern apprentices staying in work once they have qualified. Despite the reduction in uptake due to the pandemic, 447 young people started a modern apprenticeship in North Ayrshire from 2020 to 2022, highlighting the success of the programme and the motivation of young people to gain employment, boost their skill set, confidence and start a career. The Young Persons Guarantee has created 18,000 opportunities for young people, including modern apprenticeships, tackled inequalities and removed barriers preventing young people from entering employment. Apprenticeships can help to drive equity of opportunity and give employers the tools and support to be inclusive in recruitment. Skills Development Scotland strives to ensure fair workplaces and equal opportunities for Scotland's young workforce. Employers who recruit apprentices are encouraged to diversify their workforce, and there can sometimes be unconscious bias present when selecting candidates. It's vital to ensure that all frameworks, particularly STEM apprenticeships, reduce gender bias, encouraging all young people into the industry that suits them best. Young disabled people can now receive the highest level of funding for their chosen modern apprenticeship, with this scheme having supported over 5,000 disabled people as they enter employment. Happy to give way.
Stephen Kerr.
I'd like to thank Mr Gibson for the excellent speech he's giving. Does he agree that Scotland's college sector has a huge part to play in the evolution of modern apprenticeships? And does he also agree that the current set of cuts that that sector is facing as a result of this year's Scottish Government are hardly going to benefit the apprenticeship programme across Scotland?
Mr Gibson, colleges have a vital part to play, and I don't recognise the cuts agenda that he mentions. He perhaps should look at the difference between college funding north and south of the border. I think that might open his eyes somewhat. Scotland's unique apprenticeship programmes allow more flexibility to employers to ensure apprentices benefit their businesses, while offering continuous assessment to ensure that apprentices achieve their goals, technical qualifications and core skills. Comparatively, English apprentices are tied to approved programmes and must complete endpoint assessment, including core functional English and maths, meaning that many young people cannot access the benefits of these programmes. The continuing increase in apprentice numbers ensures a bright future for both the economy and the apprentices themselves as they learn valuable inter-industry skills. As part of Scottish Apprentice Week, I was pleased to visit DSM Nutrition Products Limited in my constituency yesterday, meeting six of their 36 apprentices, Jamie, Carla, Liam, Logan, Murren and Timo, to discuss their career pathways so far and their future ambitions. The company plans to employ 119 apprentices by 2024, and a number of these will work on DSM's world-beating methane-reducing feed additive for cattle, Bovar, showing the exciting opportunities that young people are offered. In her motion and speech, Pam Gosal said, and I quote, that she notes with concern the belief that apprenticeships are sometimes seen as a lesser career path when compared to university, and she was right to do so. Several young people I met were surprised to discover through the work of Skills Development Scotland and their own personal experience that can be just as successful completing an apprenticeship as they would be going to university. They all said that this is not what their teachers told them when at school, where it was made clear that anything less than university would be second best. The positive attitude of apprentices highlighted how important it is for Skills Development Scotland to engage directly with schools, parents and young people to change this misguided perception. More employers should also be encouraged to adopt work-based learning and ensure that young people know that university is not the only pathway after leaving school. Presiding Officer, I'm delighted that DSM has been nominated for Large Employer of the Year at tomorrow's Scottish Apprenticeship Awards for their commitment to increase apprenticeship opportunities and provide exciting, secure and enduring careers for our young people. And I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all the employers in Cunningham North and across Scotland that hire apprentices and look forward to seeing the numbers grow even further as Scotland recovers from the pandemic.
Thank you very much, Mr Gibson. I now call on Rona Mackay to be followed by Martin Whitfield again for around 4 minutes. Ms Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to speak in this debate to acknowledge Scottish Apprenticeship Week 2022, and I thank my colleague Pam Gosal for bringing it to the Chamber. It's always a pleasure to mark the success of an initiative that simply wasn't around during my school days. Admittedly, that was more than a few years ago. At that time, and in fact not so long ago, if you did not shine academically, you were likely to be told by the teacher, "You won't amount to anything, you can forget about a career." Imagine the damage that did to so many young people consigned to the scrap heap at such an early age. Thankfully, these days are over and the Scottish Apprenticeship Scheme plays a vital role in supporting youngsters, employers and the economy. Yesterday, I had the pleasure of visiting an amazing early years facility in my constituency in Bears Den, Lullaby Lane Nursery, to present a certificate to Chloe Winning, who recently completed her apprenticeship SVQ in Social Services, Children and Young People. Chloe joined Lullaby Nursery straight from school and has thrived in the vocational learning environment. It was clear to see that she was loving every minute of her job. Lullaby Lane Nurseries, who also have a facility in Mogai, is an exceptional business model which I would love to see replicated throughout Scotland. Director Pauline Scott, also the co-owner and director of Tigers UK, who may be known to some of you, and nursery manager Donna Adams offer a bright, airy and very much home-from-home attachment-based nursery. Outdoor and play-based learning can account for up to 80% of time spent at the nursery, and needless to say, the children love getting muddy. During the early stages of the pandemic, the nursery was open to provide care for the children of essential workers, then help provide stability and interaction for all the children at the earliest possibility. A living wage employer, there are 16 modern apprentices with the company currently training on various frameworks,
mainly social services, children and young people. With a previous Modern Apprentice of the Year winner coming from the Bears Den site, Lullaby are nominated this year for SME Employer of the Year for the Scottish Apprenticeship Awards. Two other employees are previous winners of Apprentice of the Year, so they are definitely doing something right. Pauline told me of the energy and fresh ideas that young people bring to the richness of the nursery experience. The benefits are so much more than a taster of a potential career in childcare, as much of the hands-on coaching and reflection can be applied to different career aspirations such as law or accountancy, with transferable skills such as understanding brain development, psychology, family dynamics, empathy and problem solving. Kirkintilloch High School works in partnership with Tigers to place senior school pupils in these foundation apprenticeships, offering a blended learning approach for senior phase pupils alongside the traditional high school qualifications. Presiding officer, many young people do not learn by listening. They need hands-on, practical experience, and this is why apprenticeships are so important. We now know that there are different ways of learning, of upskilling young people who go on to have fulfilling jobs and a happy life. Pauline Scott puts it very well when she says, first you start with gaining trust, building a relationship with the young person, and then comes the training and education. It really isn't rocket science, it's common sense psychology, and it's about respect, mutual respect between a young person and their mentor or trainer. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I welcome all the commitment that employers give to Scottish Apprenticeship Week, and particularly congratulate all those young people who have committed to the scheme and wish them well in their future careers. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Mackay, and I call Martin Whitfield to be followed by Paul McLennan for around 4 minutes, Mr Whitfield.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer, and can I congratulate Pam Gosal on leading a very effective and efficient first members debate this evening and with an excellent speech. And it was a great pleasure to follow Rona Mackay, who of course talked about the role that apprenticeships or modern apprenticeships play amongst our young people with regard to nursery and young care services. And this Scottish Apprenticeship Week shines a light on that vital role apprenticeships do play in supporting people, employers and the economy. Scottish apprenticeships providing the chance for businesses to adapt, sustain and indeed strengthen their business, but also providing the chance for our young people and not so young people to acquire skills and experience to underpin the future for themselves and their family. There are more than happy to
Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank Mr Whitfield for giving way? Will he take this opportunity to join me in congratulating young apprentices across East Lothian and the south of Scotland for their commitment and dedication, and in particular two inspirational young apprentices that I met yesterday, Lewis Murphy and Hayley Goldthorpe, who are both with Openreach and who are helping East Lothian families and families across the south of Scotland connect to full fibre broadband.
Martin Whitfield.
I am more than happy to extend my congratulations and in hope that their future careers are great, both to those apprentices, but also to all of the apprentices across both East Lothian and the south of Scotland who do so much, who frustrate some people at work by turning up ever so slightly late at the beginning of their apprenticeships, who forget their safety boots, occasionally even do forget their hard hats, but by the end of their apprenticeships are not apprentices anymore, but skilled operatives who understand what work is, who understand what they need to do to satisfy their employers of what they can do and make sure that our whole society goes forward in a much more safe and productive way. Here in Scotland, of course, we have three types, the foundation, modern and graduate apprenticeship, and that's very important because we are developing the model of apprenticeship here in Scotland. And as Pam says, there's a great need for that as the work that's coming down the line, many do not have yet apprenticeship pathways. I think of the Forestry Commission, where there are pathways within the forest itself, but that pathway falls apart as we look at timber production and the use of timber going on into the future. And I want to make mention, as many speakers have done today, about their visit to see an apprentice. And I had the great pleasure of going to Macmillan Coppersmith and Fabricators Limited in Preston Pans in East Lothian. The great advantage being I didn't need to take my car, I could stroll from my house, and to step into a huge warehouse that so many people have walked past and wondered what's going on. But inside, I was delighted to see the treasure of all treasures as whiskey stills, For this is the company that makes the whisky and spirit stills that go around Scotland, around the United Kingdom, and indeed around the world. To see where copper is hammered from a flat plate into a beautiful spherical shape, to see where stainless steel and copper is welded together, and to see where brass and copper is welded together. Now, for those who have uninitiated, these two metals melt at very different temperatures, and the mess that an ignorant MSP can make with a welding torch led them not to give me the welding torch, but to give me a hammer. And my great apologies to the apprentice, who I ruined almost 6 weeks of work making the beautiful swan head of his still as I whacked into it. I felt as I did as a teacher, but the other way round, when he looked at me, gently shook his head, turned around and said to his boss he'd make it better, but it might take some time. But I would like to point out to Ewan, raise Ewan in the chamber, because he guided me around the factory with calm explanations to my very silly questions. I'm a cell manager, he said. I said, oh, a cell manager, what does a cell manager do? And he looked at me with sympathy and said, well, I take care of 12 people. A man, not a boy, but a man toward the end of his apprenticeship who looks after the health and safety of other apprentices and workers. A man at the end of his apprenticeship who knows the skills that are needed, skills that are hundreds of years old, in a company that is so proud to display its founders' apprenticeship papers from all those years ago. And so to those apprentices, I say thank you. Thank you for the magic that they showed me. Thank you to the magic that they brought by explaining to me that school is not everything. I know that. Explaining to me that actually education is not just going to university. It is having the privilege to sit with a craftsman and move from someone who knows nothing to, at the end of the journey, a craftsman themselves. So at this week, during Apprenticeship Week, I thank all of the apprentices, the employers, but also I look forward, because through these apprentices, through these skills, there is a better future for Scotland, and I saw it yesterday. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. A timely reminder that not everybody is geared towards making a success of an apprenticeship there, I think. Paul McLennan to be followed by Jamie Halkett-Johnson, around 4 minutes.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I first of all thank Pam Gosal for bringing forward this motion today and joining the rest of the Chamber in celebrating Scottish Apprenticeship Week. And following Martin Whitfield and your statement there, Deputy Presiding Officer, I have a visit to a factory on Friday, and it's making me incredibly nervous now that I don't touch anything, just stand back and watch, I think. So I think, as we all said, apprenticeships are an integral part of our strategy to train a new workforce and build stable and long-term career paths, providing essential skills and valuable training. Between April and December last year, there were 419 modern apprentices in training in East Lothian, 66% of which were aged between 16 and 24. Modern apprenticeships play a key role in our school leavers' positive destination rate, and it's 96% in my constituency.
Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Does the member share my sense of regret that the decommissioning of Torness Power Station and the closure of the nuclear industry in Scotland will effectively mean that East Lothian has five fewer skilled apprenticeships through the EDF apprenticeship scheme, where people went on to high-paid and high-skilled jobs in the nuclear energy sector?
Paul McLennan.
Yeah, thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I think, obviously, that we discussed that in the Torness debate a few weeks ago. As he knows, I've spoken to the station manager. He's confident that every single person in that position at the moment will be moved on, as it was in Hunterston in that particular case. So I think he's confident that these jobs will be moved on to within the EDF itself. Around 43,000 apprenticeships and jobs in Scotland and work learning are based across Scotland. And I think one of the key things about apprenticeships also as well is that it actually aids companies. It increases productivity by 83%, it improves staff morale by 79%, and it improves staff retention by 72%. And I think some of the research also showed the most common reasons for employers supporting apprenticeships were as well to provide young people with opportunities, obviously, to train workers in core skills, and I'll touch on that later on, and to provide industry experience. And obviously, I think the Scot for Employers, apprenticeships.scot for Employers, also as the website, it advertises apprenticeships jobs for free. It has 800,000 visits a year, so it's obviously well used. And it has up to 700-plus live apprenticeship vacancies every month. Just last week, the First Minister spoke of NHS apprenticeships, their importance and their crucial role in addressing skills gap in the health service. A new £3.5 million Scottish Government recruitment programme will see 150 apprenticeship pharmacy technicians trained and recruited across Scotland. And again, I think that that's going to be critical in addressing, addressing this issue. Within East Lothian, we're facing staff and labour skills shortages in sectors such as renewables, food and drink sector and agriculture. Currently, social services and construction have the highest number of apprenticeships within the constituency. Apprenticeships are key in addressing these shortages. Not only this, our economic revival and pandemic recovery is reliant on apprenticeships and similar opportunities. But as we progress through our recovery, we must push this further. We must make an effort to encourage businesses, and they're doing well at the moment, to take on advantage of this opportunity that apprenticeships provide. This week, I'm visiting HADFAB in my constituency, an engineering company, which has a great experience and knowledge of working with apprenticeships. HADFAB have some great opportunities working with the renewable sector in the months and years ahead. And I think I mentioned in the Torness debate last week, I have a meeting coming up on the 18th with many of the renewable sector operators in East Lothian. And okay, I think there's many, many opportunities in terms of apprenticeships in that regard. Now, through the Young Persons Guarantee and Apprenticeship Employer Grant, the Government is ensuring an wraparound approach. And knowing, speaking with careers advisers in the constituency, we've heard that the free bus travel for under-22s has the potential to fuel young people's access to apprenticeships and aid employment opportunities for young people, especially in rural areas. The change in the modern apprenticeships as a rural supplement for training providers in recognition of additional costs of rural delivery shows the Government has taken a truly nationwide approach. And I'm aware that the NFU are working up a skill strategy paper to look at the issues around about agriculture and forestry. These are key sectors for rural communities. In East Lothian, due to Brexit, there are serious labour shortages. In this regard, we should be looking at module opportunities working with local colleges to offer us an extensive suite of opportunities for school leavers and others. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, I want to celebrate all the apprentices in East Lothian and beyond, and encourage school leavers out there to consider their local apprenticeships as they go forward, to consider their future, and ask businesses to review their apprenticeship offerings and consider whether there is scope for more. Apprenticeships are a valuable opportunity that you should not pass by. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr McLennan. I now call on Jamie Hawker-Johnson, who will be followed by Graham Day for around 4 minutes, Mr Hawker-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today is a good reminder of the very positive role members' debates in this chamber can play, something which has suffered during the pandemic when the business of Parliament was so severely disrupted. And having previously been the proposer of a number of Apprentice Week debates over the years, it's great to see my colleague Pam Gotal take up the mantle, and can I thank her for bringing this forward. Apprenticeship Week has always been a great opportunity to show what apprenticeships are achieving and to highlight the key role they play not only in skills-based learning but in our economy too. It was in 1994 that the modern apprenticeship era took hold in the UK, taking an ancient concept and renewing it to adapt to the conditions of our time. In that form, apprenticeships will soon celebrate their 30th birthday, a milestone, but also an opportunity to see decades of progress which has always enjoyed wide support across this chamber. Yet, like so much of what we find ourselves discussing these days, apprenticeships have taken a hit from COVID-19. After years of slow but steady growth, the modern apprenticeship starts has taken a nosedive over the pandemic. That's not a positive place to find ourselves, but is sadly reflective of the impact that this situation has had on education and opportunity here in Scotland. Of course, yeah.
Eleanor Whittam.
I thank the member for taking the intervention. I wonder, I'm the mother of a fourth-year apprentice joiner who, at the height of the pandemic, with countless apprentices all across the country, were actually working with those frontline services and keeping our void properties being turned around, people being removed from homeless situation into to properties. I wonder if you would celebrate those apprentices who actually responded in such a fantastic way across the country in the frontline.
Jamie Hawker-Johnson.
I absolutely would. There's been a huge amount of pressure, as I'll come to a little bit later, on summer apprenticeship, but a lot have taken the opportunity to stand up and play an absolutely vital role. And can I thank them and all of them across Scotland for the role that they played? I think that's a really good point. Recovery must be the priority, and it can be either fast or slow, depending on how much resource the Scottish Government are prepared to commit. And I hope the Minister will be able to go into some detail on this point. We do not want to find ourselves in years to come looking back wistfully at 2019 as some sort of better times for Scottish apprenticeships. And I've said before in this chamber that many businesses have found themselves in more precarious positions than pre-2020. And so if we're to ensure a large and diverse group of apprenticeship providers, we must ensure that business is supported and that confidence can return. Although we often think of the two new strands of apprenticeships, foundation and graduate, both now are settled into the landscape. Foundation apprenticeships are a particular area of interest, giving young people a great opportunity to experience the sort of practical approach that apprenticeships can provide. Unsurprisingly, these two have seen disruption over the last 2 years, with sizeable numbers of participants unable to complete their courses. And I welcome that some reassurance has been given to this cohort that their work will be recognised through letters of recognition. While it's also to be commended that all 32 local authorities are now involved in foundation apprenticeship delivery, the most recent figures by the Scottish Government show that 10% of state secondaries are still not engaged with the scheme, and that falls short of where we should hope to be. Growth has also seemed sometimes unbalanced. We've seen two social services frameworks expand at pace, but there is an enormous gender divide here. Meanwhile, on the other side of the coin, many traditional STEM-based frameworks remain male-dominated, around 9 in 10 participants. Choice also remains a question. As with subject choice in schools, we should be looking to ensure not just that foundation apprenticeships are widely available, but the whole breadth of learning is reflected across Scotland. One other element I'd like to consider is rurality. For regions like the Highlands and Islands in particular, there must be an increasing focus on skilling and reskilling in our rural economy. While there have been positive steps in recognising rural-based apprenticeships, demographic changes mean that these efforts must be upscaled considerably. While conditions have changed, this is not a problem that has been unforeseen. For decades, rural businesses and trades have struggled to attract new entrants. Government support in this area has been too often piecemeal and pushed problems further down the line. If we want to mend some of the regional inequalities within Scotland and our economy, apprenticeships in these sectors are a vital tool to achieve it. Deputy Presiding Officer, I am pleased once again to be able to mark Apprenticeship Week and to recognise the great work of apprentices who have often had to achieve under incredibly challenging circumstances. There is a road ahead to ensure that apprenticeships and the opportunity they provide are available and accessible to all. Let's hope that 2022 can bring some change that is necessary.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr. Alfred Johnson. I now call on Graham Day to be followed by Stephanie Gallagher. Again, 4 minutes, Mr.
Thank you, officer. One of the facets of members' debates is the opportunity they provide for all of us to indulge in a little parochialism. I mention that not by way of criticism, far from it, not least of all because I'm going to focus my contribution on the Angus South constituency that I represent. Specifically, I want to note, not for the first time, the work of an organisation which, over the approaching 11 years I've served in the Scottish Parliament, I've highlighted both in this place and via hosting visits to it by ministers, including Jamie Hepburn, and our former presiding officer, Tricia Marwick. I'm, of course, speaking about the Angus Training Group, which has been located in Arbroath for the past 56 years, during which time it has produced in excess of 2,000 engineering apprentices for a range of North East firms. This is a non-profit-making organisation supported by its member companies and Skills Development Scotland. Its role in the delivery of modern apprenticeships has been a constant during my tenure as the local MSP. That's not to say that it's not faced its challenges, because it has. But ATG has shown itself to be both nothing if not resilient and capable of adapting to the evolving nature of a changing world. Indeed, currently the organisation is engaged in a refresh of its offering in a number of areas, including robotics and automation. As I say, it has faced its challenges, especially following the oil price slump of a few years ago and then again from the pandemic. The Catherine Street Centre that the group operates from is capable of hosting 75 apprentices. On the back of the slump, it was training just 12 new starts. By 2017-18, that had bounced back a little to 23, and the following 2 years, numbers had climbed back into the mid-30s. But then came the pandemic, and an anticipated intake of 50-plus translated into just 12 modern apprentices. Difficult times, but ATG secured a contract for 30 pathway apprentices, and they built back from there. Indeed, feedback from employers suggests that the upcoming intake could rise to 40 to 45 MAs. And at ATG, are very... I did wonder which half of the Stadler and Waldorf double act would be getting to their feet, and I give way to Mr. Waldorf.
Stephen Kerr.
Okay, well, that's a compliment or not. I'm trying to work out which one was which in the Muppets, but I can't remember. Can I ask Graham Day, and welcome him to the speech, by the way, can I ask him whether he agrees that every penny of the apprenticeship levy raised in Scotland should be spent on apprenticeships?
Graham Day.
It is regrettable, presiding officer, that Mr Kerr spends his time in members' business, and he does this regularly, simply trying to snipe at the government. I would invite him, as many of his colleagues have done, to actually fashion a speech, it's only 4 minutes after all, and make a more positive contribution to these occasions. Presiding officer, ATG are very much proactive in seeking out the modern apprentices of tomorrow. Indeed, over the course of the last fortnight, their instructors have visited Carnoustie High School, Forfar Academy, Morgan Academy, and just today, Montrose Academy, seeking to entice local youngsters into an engineering career through the modern apprenticeship route. I hope that offers positive evidence that what the motion calls for around raising awareness of apprenticeship opportunities is already taking place in the engineering space, at least in Angus. But there is one area where ATG have continued to struggle, and that's in recruiting young women engineering MAs. And on this International Women's Day, that's an issue we need to reflect upon. Over the past decade, I can think of just one occasion. Indeed, of course.
Pam Gosal.
Thank you for the intervention. Just on that, do you believe that basically the Scottish Government need to do much more to promote more females into male-dominated roles in light with International Women's Day today?
Graham Day.
There's no doubt that the Scottish Government has a part to play in this, but I would contend, and I think she would probably agree with this, it's wider than that. It is about the education system. It's about society, because this is a societal problem. The kind of fashioning of gender stereotypes, that's not a job for girls, is a big problem in our society, and we need to start tackling that collectively, I would say. As I said, Presiding Officer, I've chatted to some of the young women who have taken up the opportunity, although I can think of only one occasion where more than two female apprenticeships have been part of any one intake. There was a small cohort from Aberdeen who found their way to Arbroath via a programme run through, I think it was the college in Aberdeen, which actively encouraged female entry into engineering. But in the main, the female apprentices I've met had identified engineering as a career path purely through family links. I think this is something we should all give, all of us food for thought. The engineering workforce of the future must be better gender balanced. Clearly, a great deal more work needs to be done to make that happen. I would be keen to hear from the Minister in summing up just what renewed attempts to address this long-standing issue are being made. But I reiterate, this is a societal issue. It's not about the Minister and it's not about the Government. But I don't want to wind up on a negative note, for there is overwhelmingly much to celebrate about the modern apprenticeship programme. Angus Training Group may be flag bearers in my neck of woods, but they're not alone in modern apprenticeship delivery, and I'm pleased to see the numbers in Angus beginning to rise again back to the kind of numbers they were pre-pandemic. Can I conclude, Presiding Officer, by thanking Pam Gosal for bringing forward this motion and allowing us to showcase the positive benefits of the modern apprenticeship programme Scotland-wide and in Angus South. Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Day. I would gently discourage members from name-calling other members. I appreciate it was not the most barbed of comments, but nevertheless, I'm sure it's not a warning I would need to give our next speaker, who is Stephanie Callaghan, who was the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Callaghan, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll take care not to do that. And congratulations also to Pam Gosal for bringing her very first members' debate to the Chamber. Apprenticeship Week is certainly a chance to celebrate Scotland's apprentices and the businesses that support and nurture them. As we've heard, the theme of this year's celebration is Apprenticeships Working, and I want to focus my speech, like many others, on demonstrating why apprenticeships work, not through a statistical lens, but through personal stories and insights. Presiding Officer, it seems our MSPs were out in force yesterday, and I'm absolutely no different, and my visit was to Saltire Facilities Management in my own constituency. Saltire are a Lanarkshire success story, providing boilers, renewable heating and electrical services to the community. And throughout its history, providing apprenticeships to local people has been absolutely at the heart of Saltire's workforce strategy. So we're better to get informed on why they work than from the apprentices themselves. So yesterday I met Connor, Ewan, Jonathan and Liam, four young tradesmen full of enthusiasm about their experience and, more importantly, about choosing to follow the apprenticeship route from school. Their stories are the best marketing tool for apprenticeships, and their insights are the best signposts for where we must do better as a society, as policymakers and as educators. These four articulate, intelligent young men all made personal choices to become apprentices. They knew that this path was what they wanted to do, and they're all proud of their decisions. They see themselves as following an equally valid and reputable path to those that enter university, and they were all supported by their families, like Stephen. Can't remember your surname now, Stephen, for a second. Stephen Kerr, mentioned earlier on. Amongst their peers at school, they were, however, in the significant minority, with most friends choosing university over apprenticeships. Indeed, I really did get the impression that their friends never truly contemplated an apprenticeship. It was clear from the anecdotes provided yesterday that too many families and schools still view apprenticeships as a less valuable, less marketable and less successful choice. The group that I met yesterday love their jobs. They enjoy the mix of work and learning. They enjoy the human and technical contact. They enjoy the remuneration. And they enjoy having their weekends free to socialise with their friends. And they love the security that comes with an almost guaranteed job at the conclusion of their apprenticeship. And yet, none of this same group felt particularly supported or encouraged by their schools to follow the apprenticeship path. And maybe that's something the Minister could pick up on in his closing. Presiding Officer, they were all clear that schools needed to become far more informed about foundation and modern apprenticeships. They suggested schools offer students class time to set out what different apprenticeships offer, and employers and schools needed to work more closely together to promote apprenticeship opportunities within the community. Apprenticeships work because people are earning while they're learning. They work because the opportunities directly respond to where the economy needs the skills. But apprenticeships not only work on an economic level, they also work on a social and on a community level too. The Saltire apprentices I met were caring, compassionate and confident. These trade apprentices enter between 6 and 8 houses per day, engaging with people they've never met before, talking with people who are often socially isolated, and these young men really valued those conversations and interactions. Apprenticeships, presiding officer, create good citizens. We should never underestimate their benefit to our local communities. And as we emerge from the pandemic and work towards net zero, the skill requirements for a future workforce must urgently adapt. Labour shortages in key industries, exacerbated by Brexit, means policymakers and educators need to fully harness the power apprenticeships can provide. Apprenticeships are a fundamental key to ensuring Scotland has the necessary skills for a rapidly changing employment landscape and to ensure we create the fairer, greener economy that Scotland seeks. In closing, presiding officer, the Scottish Government has demonstrated its commitment to increasing the number of apprenticeships in Scotland, and it's now incumbent on us, all of us as a society, to ensure they're encouraged and respected. Whether it's housing, healthcare or hospitality, we must cherish, celebrate and promote this crucial part that apprenticeships will play in Scotland's economic future. Presiding officer, apprenticeships do work.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Callaghan. I'm sure it won't be long before you come to know and love Mr Kerr and his interventions. And with that, I call the Minister to respond to the debate. Minister, for around 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I think we can lay the blame firmly and squarely at Mr Day's door for Ms Callaghan's misremembering, given he misnamed Mr Kerr. I can remember his name. I think Stephen Waldorf was probably what caused the problems there. Can I begin by joining others in thanking Pam Gosal for bringing her motion on Scottish Apprenticeship Week for debate. I hadn't realised it was her first members' debate. May I say, I think it was a very good choice. As Jamie Halcrow-Johnson mentioned, he used to bring this forward for debate each year, and I think it is right that we have this debate to mark Scottish Apprenticeship every year. One of the great joys I have in the activity I undertake in my ministerial role, and indeed previous ministerial roles, is the ability to meet and engage with apprentices who are engaged in work-based learning, and you can tell that it is a life-changing opportunity for them. So it is right that we recognise that by having this debate, and I thank other members for the various contributions they have made too. I'd also like to join Pam Gosal in commending the significant amount of work that Skills Development Scotland and other partners, those she mentioned, undertake to support the range of activity that takes place across the course of the week, not least to support those members with the various visits that have been undertaken or those that will be undertaken over the course of the rest of this week. I thank those members for the visits they've undertaken, even Martin Whitfield and the chaos he seemed to unleash at his visit is something I would commend to every single member of this place to engage in such a visit, because it is only through that process of engaging with apprentices and their employers that you can really understand and see firsthand the difference it makes to both. I'll certainly give way to Mr Kerr, whose name I can remember.
Stephen Kerr.
I thank the Minister for remembering my name. But can I say I also pay tribute to his commitment to the apprenticeship, modern apprenticeships across Scotland. First time I ever met the Minister was actually at Forth Valley College. And that brings me to the evidence that's been presented. And there are at least 2.5 other members of the Education Committee present in the Chamber at the moment. Evidence that's been presented to our committee suggests that Colleges Scotland are deeply concerned about the levels of cuts that they will suffer as a result of this year's budget allocations. So would the Minister share a comment, please, on their concerns, which are well-founded. It's not rumour, it's not political point scoring. They're deeply concerned about that and the impact it will have on apprenticeships across Scotland.
Minister, I can give you the time back. Yeah.
Thank you very much, President Officer. I mean, the first thing I would say, incidentally, is that the vast majority of apprenticeships are actually funded through Skills Development Scotland rather than through the budget line allocated for colleges. That relates to their core activity. There is a little, but it is in the main through a different budget line. So that's really just for clarity and information for the Chamber. In relation to the point he makes around college budgets, there's a couple of things I would say in the first instance, and we have, of course, the convener of the Finance Committee who would be able to testify to this, because I'm sure he and other members of that committee have heard directly from the Scottish Fiscal Commission that the Scottish Government this year is facing a 5.2% cut in real terms to its overall budget, some £3.7 billion less to expend this year than we did last. That's the challenge that we face. But against that backdrop, I am absolutely committed to working with Colleges Scotland and through the Funding Council to make sure that we collectively respond to the economic and societal imperatives we have through colleges engaging with their local communities, their local economies, their local employers, their local citizens to make sure that they are responsive and doing the great work that they always undertake. So, also getting back to Scottish, briefly,
Martin Whitfield.
I'm very grateful to the Minister giving way. And on this, of course, International Women's Day, wouldn't it be right to also agree to try and narrow the gap between the 40-60 split between male-female apprentices and aim for a 50-50 split going forward?
Minister.
It absolutely would be, and that was something that I was going to pick up on later, because Graeme Day made this point. We do have a challenge in that regard. Mr Day, that is, was quite right to make the point that we are dealing with, and I know Mr Whitfield and other members will recognise this, we are dealing with deeply ingrained societal attitudes that have been inbuilt over generations, and it is not easy to undo that, but it is a task that we must set ourselves and we must respond to. So through our Developing Young Workforce activity, we are seeking to make sure that we're challenging gender perceptions about what different genders do in terms of occupations. Through the Scottish Apprenticeship Advisory Board and their Gender Commission, we're waiting to see the recommendations they make. And through our Gender Pay Gap Action Plan that I was responsible for developing in my last ministerial, we will take a range of action to overcome some of those barriers. So, returning to Scottish Apprenticeship Week, I want to underline again, this is a fantastic opportunity to celebrate the achievements of apprentices and the system we have. I do want to pick up on, much as the point has been made around the challenges we have in relation to gender participation, which is a significant challenge. We also have challenges around parity of esteem. And that, again, is one that I am absolutely committed to responding. Pam Gosal, Stephanie Callan, Kenny Gibson and others made this point. There is a misperception that somehow undertaking an apprenticeship is not as high a standard as undertaking some other form of post-school qualification. That's something we need to tackle head-on, because that fundamentally is not the case. I'll give way in a wee second, but I just wanted to make the point, and it picks up on Graeme Day's point earlier. One of the, and I know there's more to life, of course, than what a person might earn at the end of their qualifications, but it is a factor for some folk. When I undertook the visit to Angus Training Group with Mr Day, I was told by that training group that the young engineers they were training will be earning significantly, I'll save their blushes by saying the precise figure, presiding officer, but will be earning significantly in excess of median earnings by age 21. And that's one measurement that shows the benefit of undertaking apprenticeship. I'll give way to Pam Gosal.
Pam Gosal.
I thank the Minister for giving me an intervention. Today, I'd mentioned earlier in my speech that in their Equality and Human Rights Committee, it was highlighted the accessibility for disabled people. And I believe that apprenticeships are there for everybody. Yes, we talked about gender, but in relation to disability, how can we help more people access apprenticeships? And this was something that was brought up from the disabled support groups today.
Minister.
So this is again another area through Skills Development Scotland Equality Action Plan that we have had a concerted focus on. I don't have the precise figures from previous years before me. I know that the latest figures for the full year we have them available for was that around 12.8% of modern apprenticeship starts had a known self-identified with an impairment, health condition or learning difficulty. That is significantly up on where we were before. So we have made improvements in that regard, but there is, again, much as I made the point in responding to Mr Whitfield, much more to be done, and Ms Gosal can be assured that we're committed to that end. I've probably extended your patience enough, but let me just quickly conclude by saying Mr Halcrow Johnson was concerned that we might look back at 2019 as the hallowed land, because we've, and he was right to recognise, and I must say some of his colleagues on those benches haven't always recognised that COVID-19 was inevitably going to have an impact on apprenticeship starts. They have. We saw that with a significant fall in the last full year before COVID hit, when we were on track to make our 30,000 target. It has had an impact. But if you look at the latest figures, we are seeing by the end of quarter three this year, nearly twice as many as we saw last year. So we are on the road to recovery. There is more to be done, but I can assure him that we will not be looking back at that period as the Haldan, because I still have great ambitions for apprenticeships, President Officer. We are going to work back towards that 30,000 target, and that is a salient reminder of the value of apprenticeships year-round, not just in this Scottish Apprenticeship Week.
Thank you very much, Minister. To the roll call of young apprentices we've heard this evening, can I add the name of Ryan, a young apprentice electrician at RS Merrimans who was working at Highland Park and I met yesterday. And with that, I conclude the debate and close this meeting of Parliament.